I pranam to all. The question I have received, we often see that when we have less time, then there comes a strong aspiration to do all that awakes from our inner self. But when we get time to do all that we aspire for, our aspiration becomes very weak and sometimes disappear also. Why this happens and how we can keep this flame, how we can keep this aspiration burning always in all contradictions? Aspiration is a fire which is with everybody. It is a gift given by the Divine. But we must understand what actually aspiration is. Many people use desire as aspiration. Some people say that I have an aspiration to eat meat. That is not aspiration, that is a desire. I have a desire to eat meat. Whatever keeps me at the human level or taking me down, that is called desire. Whatever helps me to overcome myself, go beyond myself, to exceed myself towards the Divine, that is called aspiration. Aspiration takes me towards the Divine. So this fire is with everybody. But generally what happens? Our conceptions, our desires, our ambitions, our habits, they create a wall. They create a situation where aspiration cannot flame up. On the contrary, they blow out the flame of aspiration. So, to start with, we should give less priority to our lower nature so that the aspiration will be strengthened. The intensity of aspiration will be strengthened. If we go give more importance to our desires, ambitions, our habits, then in spite of the existence of aspiration within us, it will not work. Once the aspiration, the intensity of aspiration grows more and more, then it will use our lower nature as a fuel. That is a very important part of our sadhana, which is obstructing us. That becomes the fuel for rising our aspiration. Just like when fire is very weak, a powerless wind also can wipe it out. But if power is very huge, very powerful, then the air cannot blow it out. On the other hand, it will use the air as a fuel. The same thing happens to us. Once the aspiration, the intensity of aspiration grows higher, the all obstructions become the raw material for our aspiration to grow upward. That is why it is said that desires and everything, they are by themselves not bad, because they can be used as fuel for our growth. So the intensity of aspiration is very important factor for our sadhana. The great persons, Sri Aurobindo, named Billamangala, all the great person, they had lot of limitations, probably more than us. But what happened? They become great because of the intense aspiration within them. They could use their imperfections, their limitations as a fuel for their growth. That is why it is said that a person, as far as sadhana is concerned, we should not judge what his nature is. His nature may be very bad, but if his aspiration is very strong, then he will overcome all the nature and grow ahead towards the divine. Whereas a person having good nature but having no aspiration, mother says that he is fit for the museum, he is not fit for the sadhana. He has so many good qualities, but with that good qualities, he is unable to walk towards the divine. So very important in the sadhana is the fire of aspiration, intensity of our aspiration. If that is there, then in spite of our bad nature, in spite of our lower nature, it will grow up. When the stability of aspiration will come, when we recognize that divine life is a very important occupation for our life, when we recognize, you will recognize that divine life is the most important occupation for our life, then our aspiration will be stable. Because we don't recognize this divine life as the only occupation or preoccupation for our life, then what happens? The aspiration goes towards our ambition, fulfilling our desires and everything. So there is no stability. There is a stability for some time. When we are in the right atmosphere, in the Pati Chakra, it is okay. Because we have not realized that divine life is the most important preoccupation for our life, then the moment we come out from the Pati Chakra, the other occupations will come to enter into us. Then this intensity of aspiration will not remain. There will be no stability in our aspiration. So the very important is that to recognize the life which we are leading is nothing. The divine life is the purpose of our existence. What the general life, however beautiful it might be, it has no meaning. The divine life is everything for us. Then there will be a stability of our aspiration. Next, mother says that when we learn to surrender to the divine, any difficulties are coming to us. If we learn to surrender to the divine, then the aspiration will grow again more. So the first is that not to give importance to our desires, ambitions and everything. Second is to recognize that divine life is our preoccupation. Third is surrender. Living whatever you do, don't expect anything from your action, activities. You offer the activities to the mother, then it is up to mother what she will give to you, whether she will give or not. Leave to her, because she knows when to give and what to give better than us. So the first thing is that you must give least importance to the desires, ambitions and habits. Second thing is divine life,
divine life
is our preoccupation. Third is
surrender
to the mother. Surrender to the mother means whatever you do, don't expect result from your activities. Activity, whatever you do for the mother. So you have no right to expect anything from your activities because you have given the activities to the mother. It is the mother, she will decide what is necessary for us. If we have done lot of work, she may give little to us. Somebody must have done little work, might have done little work, but mother will give more because according to the necessity she will give. Because you have worked hard, that is why I am entitled to get more. That philosophy is wrong. Why you do the work? Because you enjoy of doing working. The joy of working, that is the reason why you do the work. Not to get the result out of your work. Whatever is necessary, it will come to you if you surrender your activities to the mother. So in this way, our aspiration, intensity of aspiration will be stabilized and also grow upward. There is another question. The soul and the psychic find no place in our modern education curriculum. In such a situation, can we bring deeper truth in our education without mentioning about the soul and the psychic? For example, I see that if China had been more truthful, transparent, and less ambitious, the spread of the coronavirus would have been controlled. The whole of humanity would have avoided the spreading of corona by overcoming the fear within itself. In the same way, if the 12 qualities given by the mother symbol could be included in the school's curriculum without mentioning the soul and the psychic in the general schools, can it be considered as a step towards the mother's work? It can be considered as a step, but in order to explain in order to give the justification to the students, why the virtues will be practiced, that cannot be given through ethical education. Once we say that you follow these qualities, for example, mother said in the symbol, sincerity, humility, gratitude, perseverance, aspiration, receptivity, progress, courage, goodness, generosity, equanimity, peace. These are the qualities to be practiced. When we go to the general school and inspire them to follow these virtues in their life, can it be called as mother's work? This is the question. Yes, you can start with it, but it will not justify why they should practice these qualities. Okay, for some people, they will get the inner satisfaction. They will not ask the question. If I will ask why you are honest, because dishonest people are enjoying lot, he will answer that I am getting an inner peace when I am honest. It is okay for him. He don't need any further explanation because he himself is getting the return back. That is inner peace when he is honest. When he is practicing some virtues of divine qualities, then inside himself, he is experiencing some delight. So he will never ask question why I should practice these things. Because external happiness by pleasure is lesser than the inner joy. But if some other students will ask, they say that we don't get that inner peace, inner joy. Why I should follow these qualities? Because by following these qualities, I am deprived of all material pleasures. Those who are not following these virtues, they get more pleasurable things, money, properties, everything.
Material
properties. Why I should follow these virtues? Because I am deprived of all these things. At the same time, I am not getting inner peace. So there is an injustice to me. And this happens to many. For example, three days back I saw a story that this is the story 1984. A postman who was honest, very honest. At that time money order system was there. His officer gave him 600 rupees to distribute to the different people. So he went to different people and tried to give all the money, but unfortunately many people were absent. So he returned back 300 rupees, said that I could not meet those people, that is why I am returning back. Without counting, his officer kept the money and signed. On the next day, he said that 40 to 50 around money, there is a shortage. He said, yesterday I told you count, but you did not count. Now you are saying that there is shortage. What I will do? I have not done anything wrong. But officer suspended him and also jailed him in the police station. Though the amount was very small, that is why he came out from the
judicial custody with
bail. He came out. But his miserable life started. He had no money because he is suspended. He was not getting any salary. He had five children. And three children died because of illness. He could not cure. And rest two children he could not educate well. So they served just like a labor or somewhere like that. All money what he had to spend in the case. Court case. Even he sold his all properties to fight against the case in order to prove that I am honest. It took 29 years. After 29 years, Supreme Court declared that he is honest. By that time, all his dream is totally smashed, nothing. His family is nowhere. Now if I will tell that his child, his son, that you try to be honest, what you will say?
Say another expert.
He will not understand what I am telling. Because he has seen that his father was so honest, but whole life is smashed. So here the moral education will not justify the people like this. And people like these are more than the people who are getting the inner peace. Those who are getting inner peace, their number are very few. But those who are facing injustice, their number more than 99%. That is why moral education failed. These all things were there in the moral education. Mother, whatever 12 qualities mother said, previous to our yoga, Sri Aurobindo integral yoga, these were followed by many, but it was not successful. Moral education failed because we are not convinced why to follow. If you are not convinced, will you follow?
No.
Out of fear you may follow. Because of police, if you are not honest, he will arrest. Because of society prestige, but that will not last long. Fear-based virtues will not last long. Okay. So, these, simply telling these things will not justify him. Why I should follow? Once you include soul or psychic being, everything will be justified. How? That is why it is very important to speak about soul and psychic being. Once we introduce psychic being or soul into the fact, into our education, whole philosophy changes. First philosophy is that what you call life simply is an episode of the life. So don't expect justice in the single episode. You are seeing Mahabharata. Do you see that Duryodhana made a just injustice, and in the same episode justice is given to Draupadi? Have you seen?
No.
After 4 to 5 series you find some justice, and complete justice you will get at the end of the episode. Okay. So here we can explain him that you see, you are expecting justice, it is okay, and justice will be given, but don't expect the justice in the single episode. You exist after you leave your body. This is what we are introducing, soul or psychic being into the education. Without introducing soul and psyche being into the education, you say that my life starts with that particular day or ends with particular day. So within this, I have to enjoy my life. This honesty, these all things are nonsense. Because my life, time period is very limited. I have to enjoy it. For that, if dishonesty gives me a lot of pleasures, why I should stop? So they are justified. But if we try to convince them that whatever you are doing, if you are doing good, that is with you. If you are doing bad, that is with you. And that is carried forward to the next birth. And that, in that way you are growing more and more divine. That is the purpose of your life.
Mm-hmm.
We have come from the divine, we will become the divine. It is not in a single birth. It is through many episodes we are becoming
divine.
That is the justification. Why should I practice these divine virtues? Because whatever virtues I practice, that is making me perfect. It is helping others, okay, no problem. But very important thing is that is making me perfect.
Preparing me
towards the divine life. So this is the justice which you cannot give to any person if you don't introduce soul and
psyche.
Now the question arises that why should we believe? You are adding something to justify it is very good that very nicely you have justified. But why we believe that there is a soul or
psyche?
There the question arises, sadhana. Anything you, if you want to know, you have to practice. Here, we are introducing a new chapter to the students, saying that, okay, you do all the virtues, that is very good thing, but to know the existence of soul or psychic being must be your preoccupation. Then only all of your virtues are justified. Whatever you are doing are justified at the end. So by that, we are not only introducing the education to them to practice these virtues, but also preparing them for the sadhana. That is the purpose of our education. Without telling about psychic being and soul, you are keeping your explanation suddenly stopping somewhere where it is not justified. Can anybody will justify why I should be honest? Because many people are enjoying without being honest. Why I should be honest? There is no justification. Once you introduce soul and psyche being, everything is justified. Mentally justified. Now, that has to be realized. Mental justification, if you stop, then the question always arises that whether actually soul exists or not, we don't know. That is also another enigma in our life. So, we have to discover the soul and psyche. Then only education will be fulfilled. Otherwise, education is nothing. Mother says, illusion and delusions. Success, career, money. We are running after success, career, money. But we don't know about our life. Nothing. So these values are needed to be practiced. Initially, okay, you can introduce these things to them. But ultimately, you have to come to the
soul
and psyche. You say that, no, I don't want to use these two words. Because many people have allergy of listening these two words. We want to give some other name. You can give, but what will happen? These words are mantras. They carry the force to realize. Once you utter those words, because these words are not simply words. They are created from sadhana. Just like we are giving names, they are not given like that. Every spiritual name is based on the sadhana. That is why when you repeat Om, it carries the power of divine. When mother was in Japan, some people were uttering Om name. Om. Mother found that whole room was totally illumined. Mother did not knew about that Om word at that time, but could see that power of the Om. So these words, the soul and psychic, these words are not simple words. They carry the force to make you realize what they are. When I repeat soul or psychic being, the very psychic being prepares me towards it. It carries the power within it to make me realize that what it is. So, if you want to replace the words, nowadays everybody wants to replace the names. They want to give modern names. They feel happy, and many people feel happy, but they lose this power. Power behind the word. So we should not replace. Mother, Sri Aurobindo said, it can be replaced by the person who is a Rishi, who is equivalent to Rishi. That means a person who is authorized to replace any mantra must be at that level. Any person cannot change the mantras. To change the mantra, the person who has given that mantra, at what stage he was. If I want to change the mantra, I must be at least at that level or more than that. Then only I can change the, I am authorized to change that mantra. Otherwise, we have to follow that mantra. Then another question is, it is said that organizing study circles, conferences, involving oneself in the integral school work, or involving integral school work, etc., are direct mother's work. It is said that organizing study circles, conferences, involving oneself in integral school work, etc., are direct mother's work. If I work in the field of education, not directly in an integral school, but creating classroom environment to establish truth, helping the students to find out the deeper meaning of their life, etc., in general school, can it be called mother's direct work? If yes, is the same applicable to other fields like agriculture, politics, health, etc.? The question is that generally we call mother's work when we are in the, we are directly involved into the study circles or in the integral education or conferences related to Sri Aurobindo and mother. We call that is direct mother's work. The question is, if a person introduces the values of integral education in the general school, can it be called as mother's direct work? In other fields also, agriculture, politics, health, if he does, he has gone through the mother and sister writings, he has realized the values and trying to practice in the ordinary schools and institutions. Can it be called mother's direct work? Initially, if it is, it is to be done, but directly mother's work means they need an institution. Why I am saying? Suppose the scientist of NASA, whatever he is experimenting, can he experiment in ordinary laboratories?
No.
Why?
The facilities not available.
The special facilities required in the NASA are not available in the
ordinary
laboratories. Similarly, Sri Aurobindo education is the education of the future. It is related to the education directly linked to the supramental consciousness. Okay. Whatever you are giving studies, they are only skeletons. But it has to be linked with the supramental consciousness. For that, they need an institution where things will be organized in such a way that a research work can be done based on Mother and Sri Aurobindo. Mother and Sri Aurobindo's writings are not simply a preaching. It is an experiment to be discovered something which will help you to become supermental being. That is not yet discovered. Mother and Sri Aurobindo, whatever they have done, that we have to discover through education, through politics, through everything. For that, they need institutions where all the facilities will be available. If the facilities will not be available, these greater experiments cannot be done. You can go and preach everybody everywhere about Mother and Sri Aurobindo. Indirectly you can help all the schools. It is okay. But deep-rooted experiments are not possible. Otherwise, Sri Aurobindo could have started his work remaining in Calcutta. Why he has come to Pondicherry started an ashram. Why mother had to come here? And Sri Aurobindo said, if mother was not here, I could not have started my yoga. Why this is very, very important is to establish an institution, means availing all the occult facilities. In the ordinary laboratory, there are physical facilities. Here, they need occult facilities. Those are needed. Then only they can experiment. Sri Aurobindo had to remain in the single room because that was necessary for his experiment. Not only that, our ashram started in the year 1926. Mother says that from 1926 to 1956, how many years? It was simply an institution. It had no collective reality. Everybody was there, living together, but living for himself. So it was an institution where people lived together, but there was no collective reality. Collective reality took birth after supramental manifestation in the year 1956. Then actually Sri Aurobindo Ashram's real work started. So you see how the infrastructure is necessary. It is not simply saying that yes, we can do everywhere. Ashram established in 1926, still it had to wait up to 1956 to have collective reality. From there, the ashram could start its real work after 1956. Similarly, International Education Center. Mother said, it is very much necessary to wipe out the miseries of the humanity. Why she has established an institution? Why she has established an institution, Sri Aurobindo society for spreading Sri Aurobindo and mother? They could move from here to there. But why they have established an institution? There is a flight. It can go from one place to another. Why there is an airport? So there is a place where it has to establish itself and do something and spread everything. So simply saying that institutions are not necessary, it is not correct. Institutions are very much necessary. Why mother established Auroville? It was necessary. So you can do, if you want to do those works, okay, no problem. But the deeper, if you want to do the deeper aspects of the integral yoga, then there need to be ashram. That is why Mother Sri Aurobindo insisted in future there will be Gnostic societies, Gnostic communities, where the people having the same aspiration will live together. People having the same aspiration will live together and discover something for the future. There will be so many Gnostic families based on the collective aspiration. Our family is based on the circumstances. Why you are here? Because of physical circumstances. I took birth in this family, he took birth in this family. That is why we both are two brothers. But his aspiration is different. My aspiration is different. We are staying together. Okay. But Gnostic family is based on the free choice. I have the aspiration, you have the aspiration, we have decided freely, without any compulsion, to stay together. Then only we can discover something for the future. So, the answer is that you can do all type of activities indirectly, but direct mother work, mother's work is possible with institutions. Then the question is, in the married life, Maintaining harmony between the life partners is very difficult, especially when one is interested in yoga and other is interested in bhoga. Prayers, of course, is one of the best means to maintain harmony. But are there any practical means, especially from the action viewpoint? There are two points here. One is before marriage and another is after marriage. Before marriage, you have to ask yourself whether marriage is needed for you or not. Not from your impulse. If you will study from your impulse, you will feel that yes, it is necessary. Mm-hmm. Go into the deep and ask yourself whether marriage is necessary for you. If it is necessary, then you have to find out what type of life you want to lead. If you want to live ordinary life, then better to marry an ordinary person. Mm. If you marry a yoga sadhak, then you will be frustrated. Mm. You will ask him to take a beautiful film, he will be somewhere else, in the study circle or somewhere else. So there will be discernment. So if you want to lead a common life, a life of enjoyment, life of pleasure, so choose a person who wants the same thing. Of course, there also the disharmony arises because the preferences will change. Mm-hmm. Your preferences will change and
his preferences will change.
You want to see the cricket match, he wants to see Ramayana. So, so you have to keep two TVs mm-hmm. in the house. A child will come, I will see the cartoon picture. So all these things, there are so many disharmonies, still will be able to, still it can be maintained. So whole thing is that if you want to live ordinary life, try to choose a partner having the same impulse. But it is not assured that you will have a harmonious life, because in the lower nature there cannot be any harmony. Mm-hmm. In the lower nature, there cannot be any harmony. Still, it is better because we are in the same level. Mm-hmm. Second is that if you are in intellectual level or artistic level, aesthetic level, same thing Mother and Sirona says, that you choose a partner who is having the same tendency. Mm-hmm. Then you will discuss in the night also the same thing mm-hmm. about arts and about your intellectual things. If you are a collector and your wife is also a collector, or if not collector, some equivalent intellectual capacity, then in the evening also you can talk each other.
Same thing.
And she will get interest to know, you are also interested to share. You will also get interest to share. So in case of intellectuality and higher cadre of life, you have to choose the partners like that. There also disharmonies will be there, because the preferences will be different. Though both are intellectual, but preferences will be different. So there must be a compromise. Always there must be a compromise somewhere. Then the third is coming, if you want to live a spiritual life. Mother says, Sri Aurobindo said, think 50 times. Because it is rare of the rarest that you will get the spiritual partner. Rare of the rarest. Spiritual partner, it is not easy to get. 50 times you have to concentrate, then if there is a grace, then you will get. Otherwise, in market it is not available, what you will do? Spiritual partners, scarcity, there is a scarcity. Okay. They will tell that I will help you, I am from the study circle. These all things are nonsense. I have done so many Patchakras. My father and mother were also devotees. These stories are nothing. Mm. Okay. Whole thing is that very rare on the rare persons you will get as a spiritual
life partner.
Life partner. Okay. So you have to think 50 times. Now I think it will be more, 1,000 times. So this is the before marriage. After marriage? After marriage, we will pass through 3 stages generally. One is first phase is golden phase. There is no good and bad. Everything appears best. Even bad things appear
good.
Good. Your wife initially will look very beautiful, even though she is not beautiful. Everything appears good. So there is no problem at all. Because when you see bad as good, good as good, golden period, no problem. But it will not last long. Second phase will come when both good and bad are seen as good and bad, really, as it is. So here the solution is that give importance to the good, forget about the, close your eyes towards the bad. So then you can live nicely, but old, just opposite happens. We give importance to the bad and forget the good things.
Good.
Okay. So here we can do one thing, that is forgetting the bad and giving importance to the good, we can lead our life, marriage life. Then the third stage will come when bad, good and bad will appear worst. Even good things will appear as bad. When your wife will laugh, you will get angry. Why you are laughing? Everything, all of her action will appear as something as bad. This is the third phase.
Domestic violence.
So it is this stage, mother has given a solution that if you want to do sadhana, then take it as a psychological crisis for practicing the equanimity in your consciousness. When everything appears bad, that is the opportunity for those for practicing
Equanimity.
But it is not possible for all. Very few can take this time as an opportunity. Okay. In that case, mother said that temporary or long term or short term, separation is advisable. Separation means you stay somewhere and she will stay
somewhere
else. And at that time you will realize the good qualities of the other person. Okay. When you are together, you cannot see the good things. When you are very far and the time is increasing day by day, you will remember more and more the good qualities of the person. And if he dies, only good qualities will be visible. Bad qualities will not be visible. Okay. So separation is necessary if you cannot practice
equanimity.
Whether it is long term or short term, that depends according to your discoveries. If you discover, I can stay again with him, okay, no problem. If separation is always needed, that is also advocated. Even that is called Vanaprastha in our Purana Shastra. They were searching divine separately. So we have done our home duty well. Every of my child is well established. Now you do your sadhana, I will do my sadhana. They used to go to the forest. Now forests are not available. That is the
ashram.
Now ashrams are there. So separation is very much essential. Otherwise, mother said, so many crimes will take birth. So many, and are taking birth. If you listen that why husband has killed his wife, because he could not tolerate her. Why husband, wife killed the husband, because he could not tolerate her. And society is compelling them to stay together. Mother said, no, it is very bad thing. That is why the crimes are increasing day by day. The moment you feel that you cannot stay together, try to live together with equanimity. Practice. But if it is reaching to the peak level, where every action appears something wrong, then it is better to remain to live separately and love each other. Separately and love each other, no problem. Over phone you talk 10 times, no problems. No. But you live apart. That will help you much. So this way, and the harmony can be experimented, but true harmony is only possible when both are attuned to the divine. In the highest consciousness only, harmony is possible. In the lower consciousness, even in the mental consciousness, it is not possible. So ultimately, both of you, husband and wife, must be yogi. Yogi means connected to the divine. Yoga. Connection to the divine. Both. Then only there will be harmony. Whether they live together, whether they live separately, it is not important. Living together, if there is no harmony, why to live together? It is always better try your level best to live together. But never compel yourself to live together. Another question is, on the one hand, it is said that everything is predestined. On the other hand, it is also said that the quality of your life depends on the choices that are made every moment. If everything is predestined, then where is the scope to make a choice? These are not contradictory terms. Are self-fulfilling terms. One is, when it is said that predestined, everybody is predestined to become divine. Because we have come from the divine, therefore we will become the divine. It is predestined. Nothing will stop. Even you cannot stop. You can only delay the issue. So, once your life, you are living in the life, you are destined to become divine. But in what way you will become divine? That is your choice. There the freedom of choice is there. In what way you will start your journey? That is your choice. But you are destined to be divine. You must be divine because you are from the divine. Since I have come from the divine, I have every right to become divine. Nobody can stop. Even I cannot stop. I can only delay the issue. Okay. So, where the freedom is? Freedom is my choice. About, there are four types of forces are working, five types of forces are working over here. They are like five vehicles. Which vehicle am I using? One is nature. Another is supreme. Third one is higher force, dynamic force. Fourth one is lower force. Fifth one is hostile force. These are the five vehicles through which you will reach to the supreme. So which vehicle you want to use? That depends. how much time it will take, how beautifully it will take or how painfully it will take, it depends. If you use the nature as a vehicle, then it is just like what you do, proportionately you get. There is no increase, no decrease. Nature will not add you or neither deduct you. According to your karma phala, you will proceed. Whatever you have done, accordingly you will proceed. That is, if you are under the nature. Okay. If you are under the supreme, then your destiny becomes the supreme. Whatever the divine wants, that will become your destiny. No karma phala, nothing will apply to you. But it is very difficult to be under the supreme. Okay. Once, but that is the best means, because the divine will be your destiny, the best way. But it is not very easy to be under the supreme. Third one is under the higher forces that will accelerate your karma phala. That means you will reach your journey. Will be accelerated. You will reach very quickly, more quickly than when you are under the nature, towards the divine, supreme. If you are under the lower forces means your desire, ambition, higher forces means the qualities, virtue. The greater virtues, as I say, told, unselfishness, love for others, all the divine qualities, they are the higher forces. Okay. When I become happy for others' progress, that is higher quality in me. We are never happy for others' progress. If anybody, even my own intimate friend, if he is happy, then I cannot tolerate. So, that is a very good quality. If I am under the higher forces, then these are my qualities. Unselfishness, love for others, gratitude, sense of gratitude, courage, all these things will accelerate my journey. If I am under the lower forces, that is desire, ambition, selfishness, all these nonsense, what will happen?
It will decrease, accelerate.
It will slow down the process of the karma phala. Karma phala at the rate which I was traveling, even that will be reduced. If I am giving importance to my desires, ambitions, all these habits, so-called habits, then my journey will become slow towards the divine. Then another thing is hostile force. It will take you backward journey. That will also meet to divine. Because backward journey means, suppose where is your nose? I will tell you, this is my nose. I can show my nose also.
This type.
Backward journey. Okay. So once you are under the hostile force, your journey, you are coming, according to your karma phala, you are reaching here, suddenly he will take in that direction. Okay. Ultimately you will reach
divine.
To the divine, but how many births, how many special graces are required, you don't know. Once you are possessed by the hostile force, ordinary grace is also not sufficient. They need special grace. Yes. So how many special grace will be needed? When you will come back to your goal, when you will reach to your goal, nothing can be said. So, from one point of view, everybody's life is predestined, but how and when is our choice. It will take many years or lives to know the divine will. It will take many years or lives to know the divine will. Till that, it is suggested to use remember and offer as the mantra for making the best decisions. But still then, we are landing up in the chaos. So, is there any way to make correct decision before knowing the divine will? Yes, there are so many ways. You don't take correct decision, the divine will take correct decision for you. The first need is unshakable faith on the divine. If you have a faith which is not shaken by the outward circumstances, outer circumstances, is the strongest and surest guide in the darkest days to go through and arrive at the goal. So, even if you do not know what is the divine will, still you can do right thing if your faith that is not shaken by the outer situations. A faith that is not shaken by the outer situations. If corona is coming, then our faith is shaken. What will happen? What will happen? That means that faith is not
perfect.
That is not so powerful. If it is not shaken by the outer circumstances, then that faith itself will be your guide, surest guide in the darkest days to go through and arrive at the divine goal. It is the gleam sent to us by the divine to walk before the sunrise. Even before sunrise, there is a gleam of the sunrise. Through that light, we can walk clearly. So faith is just like that. Before sunrise, there is a gleam. With that gleam, we can
reach
the goal without making any mistakes or blunders. It is a sort of inner certitude which guides the ignorant, simple people to do the right thing at the right moment and in the right way. If you are very simple, don't doubt the divine. Never doubt the divine. You are so simple. Then what will happen? For the people who are ignorant and simple, they are being driven to the way. They will do the right thing at the right moment in the right way without knowing. So that faith has such power. Then another thing is that surrender. If you surrender, then also mother says surrender means you don't live for yourself, your sake, you live for the divine. That is surrender. Whatever you do,
only for the divine.
Try to live for the divine. That is surrender. If you want to live for yourself, your ambition, your future, then that is not surrender. Surrender means I want to live for the divine. Whatever he wants, I want to become. So, what will happen? We will be able to do the right thing in the right way automatically before having the knowledge. Again, the same thing. Before having the knowledge, we can do right thing in right way automatically before having the knowledge. Another third one is we have given the mind. We can use our mind methodically, observe and analysis, though that will not give the right direction, but it will save us and protect us from doing the blunders. If we use our mind rationally, so many blunders can be saved. So these are the points. First is
unshakable
faith. Second is
surrender.
Third is using our mind.
Rational mind.
so that that will help us to
not to do any blunder.
Blunder, that's all. It will not show the right path, but it will save us from the blunders. Because mind is also blind. It cannot show us the right path. But it will control our blunders, our vital blunders. Vital is more blind than the mind. So if mind is not used, it will do blunders, our vital, our habits, everything. So it will control the vital impulses and physical habits, so that so many blunders can be
stopped,
minimized. Then another question is, what is the effect of communal violences between Hindus, Muslims and Christians? People easily come to bad conclusion, leading to mass violence and murders. In the light of the Mother and Sri Aurobindo's sayings, what should be our role here? Muslims follow their Islam religion obstinately and nothing else. How to make them understood about Sri Aurobindo's ideology? First of all religions, Hindu, Muslim and Christians, they represent certain truth. Truth is a big thing. I see truth from my point of view. Muslim sees truth from their point of view. Christians say from their point of view. Okay. As far as the followers of Sri Aurobindo and Mother says that try to harmonize the truths behind the religion. Okay. So that your truth will be integral, more integral. Christian truth is something. Muslim truth is something. Muslim's truth is force, power. Christian truth is love. Okay. So every Hindu truth is something in depth. It is representing the deeper aspect of everything. So all these things we have to harmonize. Otherwise, we are not the followers of Mother and Sri. Those who live on the surface, they always fight. I am Hindu and fighting against Muslim. I am with Muslims. That means I am not Hindu. Muslims fight against Hindu. That means they are not Muslims. Because they are wasting their time. All. So this communal feeling itself is a narrow, it is proving that our consciousness is very narrow. Mother said that only the narrow consciousness will indulge in these things. Only the narrow consciousness will indulge in these things, but the higher consciousness, what will do?
Integrally it will view.
It will take the truth behind everything and harmonize everything. Suppose there is an orchestra party. A guitar is representing some truth. Harmonium is representing some truth. Sitar. All instruments are representing certain truth. If we can harmonize all these instruments, the song will be
beautiful.
Sweet and excellent. If they will fight each other, guitar, there will be a union president, guitar president, and there will be a harmonium president. So they will fight each other. What will happen to the song?
Barrier.
There cannot be any song. That is what happening to our religions. They are beautiful instruments, but I am using guitar as a stick to fight him. He is using his harmonium to beat me. What happened? What will happen to us? That is what happening now. So instead of let them do whoever are doing, we should not involve in these things. We should try to find out the deeper truth of all religions and harmonize it so that you will be fit for the transformation. That is our role. Second thing they said about Muslims, they follow their Islam religion obstinately. From one point of view, they are doing the right thing. What if you follow mother obstinately, is it good or bad?
Good.
Good. Is it not? Mm. If they follow their religion obstinately, it is good. Mm. But unfortunately, they are misguided.
Mm.
Their leaders misguide them and they follow obstinately. That is the problem. Otherwise, if they follow their religion, true religion, obstinately, that is the good thing.
Mm.
They are being misguided by the people, saying that if you kill so many people, you will go to Jannat.
Mm.
Jihad. Mm. These all things are misguiding. Mm. Nothing, they are not properly guiding the people.
Mm.
And they are following obstinately that. The people, ignorant people, obstinately follow these people, those who are misguiding.
Mm.
There the problem is coming. Otherwise, to follow obstinately, here also it is required. I am always saying that follow mother obstinately. Is it not?
Mm-hmm.
Huh? But you have to understand mother rightly. If you understand in your own way and follow her, thinking that you are following mother, you are following a devil force.
Suicide bomber.
Yes. So, following religion obstinately is not bad. Understanding the religion properly, experiencing the religion properly, and then be obstinate. Otherwise, if you are not obstinate, you cannot follow properly. Anywhere, scientist is very obstinate in his research. He is forgetting his meals and marriage also. He is so obstinate. That obstinacy is required, otherwise you cannot be great. So obstinacy is not a problem. Problem is that understanding of the religion. How you understand. And how can we make them understand? That is not our duty. We speak what mother said. Totally with surrender. It is mother's work. Mother will do the rest. If I want to convince you, that is not the way. At least Sri Aurobindo and mother's way are not like this, that I must convince you. I will explain my experiences, my feelings to you. It is up to you whether you will accept or not. I will pray to the mother, mother, I have done as far as possible. It is up to you whether you make him ready in this birth or next birth. Or how many births, I don't know.
Huh?
It is up to you. Why I will get tense because he is not accepting mother and Sri Aurobindo? Supreme once requested mother, saying that his guru, who was a tantric,
Swami,
said that he is a very good tantric, but he is unable to understand transformation yoga. Please, give some grace so that he will become the sadhaka of Sri Aurobindo Yoga. Mother denied, said that no, he is not ready yet. He's good, no problem. But for Sri Aurobindo Yoga, he is not ready. If he is not ready, if you will compel them to do that, what will happen? There will be imbalance in the consciousness. Neither he will be where he was, neither he will be where he should. That is the problem. So we are not here to convert Muslim into Hindu or something else.
Mm.
Or sorry, Sri Aurobindian. Not like that. We are here to just present what mother and Sri Aurobindo have said. Rest is upon them and mother. Whether they will accept or not, it is up to them. And whether mother will give grace to them or not, that is up to them.
Not the mere trace of mind.
No, initially you will not know. Because whatever vital is doing, it will give a feeling also that it is doing the right thing. So initially you will not know. Once you try to control the vital or enlighten the vital through your mind or psyche, then you will know that whether you are in the right path or wrong path. Initially, you have to simply assume that because you are in the vital, so you are in the you are never in the right path. But it will not give you that feeling.
So I want to introduce integral yoga to my friends, and what I may do if they are not interested.
No, if they are not interested, still we have to tell them what we want to tell. That's all. But whether they will accept or not, that is up to them. We have no role. Because sometimes what happens, initially they reject, but within themselves they accept. Some consciousness within them accept us. Though outwardly they reject and oppose. So if we continue our job, then sometimes what happens that they will say that, oh, you are doing you are telling the right thing, but we never understood in this way. So we have to continue our work in spite of their opposition and whatever it is. We have to continue with love and affection.
So the mother has said that Savitri alone is enough to realize supramental truth without the necessity of a physical guru. So how to approach Savitri, how to read Savitri, how to open ourselves to Savitri so that she reveals something
to us? No, anything you see, if Savitri alone was enough, then why mother and Sri Aurobindo wrote so many books? So, once we reach to the Savitri, then it is enough. How to reach? There are so many guides. Suppose if you like Mother and Sri Aurobindo's or Mother's question and answer books, it inspires you. You first read that book. And after reading those books, your consciousness grows. After the development of your consciousness, you will have the interest to go through the Savitri, and during now also you can just simply practice by reading the Savitri as a mantra. That's all. Even though you don't understand, that you continue. At the same time, don't limit yourself to the Savitri. You go through the all writings of Mother and Sri Aurobindo. Many people think that since Mother has said only Savitri is enough, they don't read other books. That is what Mother said, that if you want to quote anything from Mother and Sri Aurobindo, you have to read all the books of Sri Aurobindo and Mother. Then only you are authorized to speak about Mother and Sri Aurobindo. So when Mother says something, we have to have a deep understanding about this. Not simply saying that, oh, this is enough, that is why I need not read other books. Till the Savitri is interesting, I have to go through other books. Once I get the interest in Savitri, then also other books are necessary, because so many explanations you will get from other books.
There are many evil forces around us.
Yes.
And due to our weaknesses, we get attacked by them easily. How do we fix these evil forces? How do we face forces?
No, the mother says initially you should not concentrate that there is a evil force. Okay, if you concentrate that there is a evil force, that will become powerful. Think that only mother is there, nobody is there. Okay, that will, if you don't believe their existence, that will help you much more than believing that they are around you and trying to do damage to you, all these things. By believing them, they are becoming powerful. Even though they exist, if you don't care, if you don't give any importance to them, they will lose all the powers. That is the first thing. Second thing is that these evil forces, they can only attack our insincerity. They cannot attack our sincerity. Mother said that where there is insincerity, they can enter and disturb you. So try to become sincere in your all actions, on your all thoughts, in your all feelings. Once you become sincere, no force can attack you.
And how do we pass it on to our younger ones?
Which one? What will pass? Your hostile force you will pass?
How to make them ready for...
Not necessary. They are very in the right consciousness. They are not never afraid. We make them afraid. Now the corona, they did not know anything. We have made them aware that, oh, there is a big hostile force attacking them. They did not know about it. Their ignorance is their blessing.
So